So with that, I'd like to turn to our first speaker. Would you please welcome Nick Lemann?
Thanks, Matthew. And let me say first, I will not speak for 15 minutes. And that's partly because I want to leave time to interact with this very distinguished audience, and partly because my two fellow panelists do this full time for a living, and they're about the best two people you could find to talk about this. I do not. What am I doing here? I think where I can add a little is more me as a journalist. I have a kind of double life as a journalist and a person in a university. And as a journalist, I can maybe help set the stage by explaining what I think is the answer to the question Matthew posed about why is this such a hot topic right now. I have a colleague named Catherine Schultz who wrote a wonderful book a few years ago called Being Wrong, which is a kind of exploration of epistemology, highly recommended. And in that book, Catherine makes the point that human beings are unfortunately addicted to inductive reasoning. And that's part of the problem here, particularly for my journalistic colleagues. So a thing happens that is dramatic, and then we wildly overextrapolate from that thing. That thing, in my view, I don't know if you all agree, is the, I guess it was 2011-12 school year, the course that Sebastian Thrun offered at Stanford, you know, that was a MOOC on a computer science course that had, I think, 160,000 signups. Mm-hmm. And suddenly, many of my colleagues in the press, and you know, I want to differentiate between the education press, which tends to do a better job, and the kind of elite opinion press, which flits from subject to subject and gets overexcited about some things. So suddenly, you know, there was a lot of other things happening in the background, including the other half of my business, the newspaper business, actually has been disrupted in an incredibly dramatic way. So we had a close at hand example. We thought, who's next? Somebody's got to be. Maybe it'll be universities. And we had seen the incredibly sudden rise of a series of big companies, internet-based big companies, Amazon, Google, Facebook, and so on, that built, you know, massive audiences and really dominant, unshakable market positions very quickly. And you know, as you all know, there's a lot of sort of millenarian rhetoric around the internet anyway, and a lot of people with business interests in promoting such rhetoric. So out of that came a hasty narrative or conclusion or something that MOOCs, which, as Matthew pointed out, are really a tiny subset of what we're here to talk about, which is technology and education, were going to be, you know, the big disruptor in higher education. You've heard this before. Higher education is the only institution in our society that hasn't changed at all since medieval times, and there's this incredible replication and inefficiency and Baumol's paradox and so on and so forth, and the rising costs and people can't get jobs and the $1.2 trillion of debt. And boom, here's the answer, which is, if I can play this out in its most perfervid form, in the future there'll be a radically smaller number of higher education institutions that will be truly global, and everybody else is going to go away. And it's all going to happen in tsunami-like fashion. So this, you know, and everybody works, I'm sure everybody in this audience has had some conversation at Thanksgiving dinner, at a cocktail party, or something where some person who doesn't work in a university sort of flings this at you, and you have to respond. I think the fever has died down a lot since then. I you'd probably agree, but mm-hmm. but there it was, and it ignored a whole bunch of things, you know, which we could go on and on about, but just a few. First of all, when all this was happening, there was a pre-existing, somewhat long existing real world of online education, and that real world was Places like University of Phoenix, University of Maryland, Baltimore County, other big purveyors. And what they did was almost the opposite of MOOCs in many ways. They had small format classes taught by people who were not academic superstars, and they were teaching skills to people who were a long way away. And you know, you may know some of these people. They go home at night and they grade papers of their online students. A lot of service members who were serving in places like Iraq and Afghanistan were taking online courses, for example, for one of many examples. So there was this kind of disconnect between MOOCs and the real world of online ed as it existed. If you want to be really broad about it, what is technology? What was supposed to be revolutionary about MOOCs, at least as some people were stating the case, was Michael Sandel can give his justice course to somebody in a village in Kashmir, which is a wonderful thing. But even when all of us were in college, you know, we had textbooks, and the textbooks were made by printing presses, which arguably counts as, does that count as technology? Maybe. But the point is, it was the model of the very best academic superstars in the field produce curriculum material that is mass distributed, and then that the direct contact is done by lesser mortals who meet with their students personally in smaller groups. So the basic idea that now for the first time in history, everybody has access to the thoughts of the very top people in the academy just isn't true, and it's not a useful model. So I guess for my suggestion for the rest of the panel is, you know, my guess is this is not the crowd that is dying to have my appetite is growing to hear about the coming disruption of higher education conversation. So I'm guessing we're not going to have that conversation anyway, which is a good thing. I think it's useful as a first instance, as an opening supposition, not to frame this as being a kind of administrative and economic question about the future of the existing set of higher education institutions and faculty members and their lives. Because then it gets into this other discussion that's sort of embedded in it. Do you like the status quo and want to preserve it? Do you see changes threatening? Do you hate the status quo and want to blow it up? Embedded at a deeper level in a lot of this unstated is, do you believe in research universities, or do you believe research universities with things like tenure, academic freedom, non-skills courses shouldn't really exist, and this can be a sort of pretext for getting rid of them? That discussion is not that useful for our purposes, I would propose. Maybe we should get to it. But to me as a teacher, which I now am, what's most interesting and what I most want to hear about from my colleagues is how can this improve teaching and learning? And possibly in ways that are more kind of rigorous than we've been able to have access to in evaluating teaching and learning. It might be a way to do what everybody always says they want but never quite happens, which is elevate the importance of teaching in the panoply of what universities do. And I'll just finish by telling you what I as a teacher am frustrated with or feel I need help with. First, it's a little bit back to the textbook analogy. A lot of one's life comes down, sadly, to if you can have access to, you know, half a dozen brilliant coders from Stanford, you can really make your course into the hybrid course of your dreams and use these online tools really effectively. But since you don't, you've got, you know, four big, essentially the current version of textbook publishers who have off-the-shelf products, and you just have to choose one of them, and you don't have much ability to customize or modify. Certainly at the individual level, often at the department or school level, and even at the college or university level. That's a problem I'd like to hear the answer to. And then the other thing is just a kind of technical question, but it is what I have found most frustrating in teaching online myself, which is the day going to come when you can offer a synchronous class online that really feels like a seminar and doesn't have delays and weird stuff going on? Because that, it seems to me, would be a very big breakthrough. So I'll stop there and hand the baton to you to answer those or other questions.